Hello friends, I am Dr. Divya Tiwari, Associate Professor at Department of Philosophy, Zakir Hussain Delhi College, University of Delhi. Today we will learn about the debate between liberalism and communitarianism. So let us start with the introduction. The debate between liberalism and communitarianism is not confined to one discipline. It emerges in philosophy, political science, and law, and it erupts around different issues within each of the disciplines. The liberal communitarian debate covers a varied range of issues and theorists, and there is no simple contrast between liberalism and communitarianism. Liberalism as a political and moral philosophy is centered on two main principles, individualism and liberty. Liberalism endeavored to protect the liberty, rights, and equality of individuals against the evils of society, nation, state, etc. Communitarians have been the major opponents of the central principles of liberalism. Liberalism has been considered by the communitarians to be excessively individualistic. Communitarians have been the major opponents of the principles of liberalism. Liberalism has been considered by the communitarians to be excessively individualistic, as it overlooks the importance of the good of community. It concentrates on the issue of rights and treats the self as transcendental, neutral to the historical and contingent factors of a tradition or society. In this way, liberalism has presented an abstract, historically desituated and unrealistic notion of the self. Liberals have responded to these criticisms and have modified their theory by accommodating the importance of community in the life of an individual. Still, they have given subordinate place to community over the individuals. They have also offered some challenges to their chief opponents, the communitarians. They have demanded some alternative communitarian account which can resolve the alleged defects of the liberal theory. Further, the liberals criticized the communitarians for overemphasizing the importance of the community over the individual. It gives importance to the shared understandings of communities, public participation, and a sense of solidarity and fraternity. Liberals have argued that this can lead toward the exploitation of the rights, autonomy, and liberty of individuals. It is beyond the scope of this module to deal with all the issues that have occurred during the whole debate between the liberals and the communitarians, and hence will be limited to these points of debate. Individual autonomy or the good of community, the notion of the self, neutrality of the state, the problem of pluralism in a liberal democratic society, the priority of the right over the good, the primacy of justice, etc. These are some important points over which the debate has been centered at large. The autonomy of an individual and the idea of community. Now let us come to the autonomy of an individual and the idea of community. Liberalism has been charged with being individualistic and for overemphasizing the autonomy and rights of individuals. The notion of liberal individualism could be found in the theories of Locke, Kant, and Rawls. Locke's political theory presents the individualist theory of popular sovereignty, as in his hypothesis of the state of nature, he gives all powers in the hands of the individuals. He, through his works and original hypothesis, presented the model of the individual popular sovereign, in terms of which man possesses autonomy, liberty, and rationality. This notion of individual popular sovereign lies in the definition and origination of political power proposed by John Locke, in which the conditional entrustment of political power to government by the consent of the people plays the central role. According to Kant, the social contract is based on a coalition of the wills of all private individuals in a nation to form a common public will for the purposes of rightful legislation. Kant believes that individuals' autonomy and freedom is necessary for the attainment of enlightenment and moral agency. He advocates of the self-legislation of each individual, who is considered to be an end in himself. John Rawls presents a module of the original position in which behind the veil of ignorance, the representatives choose the principles of justice, which assure basic liberty, rights, equality of opportunity to individuals, and is in accordance with the welfare of the least advantaged section of society. He considers individuals to be rational and reasonable, and the self remains prior to its end. The views of these thinkers show that they have given priority to the individual over their affiliation to any group. The individual is independent, autonomous, and possesses rights. However, liberal individualism does not promote selfishness or alienation. Autonomy is a capacity of self-direction and self-creation, and it can be exercised only in certain specific social conditions which encourages such values. It is compatible with the values of a community. Against the charges of the communitarians, liberal thinkers have claimed that liberal theory is fully capable of accommodating the idea of community. Locke has presented the role of majority rule in a democratic society. In practice, Locke supposed that the will expressed by the majority must be accepted as determinative over the conduct of each individual citizen who consents to be governed at all. According to Locke, the formation of a civil society requires that all individuals voluntarily surrender their rights to the civil society at large. Once the society has been formed, the individuals are supposed to entrust their lives, liberty, and possessions to the supervision of the community as a whole. The notion of community can also be seen in the philosophy of Kant, Lucas, Thorpe. Thorpe holds that Kant's moral idea of a realm of ends is modeled on the category of community. According to Kant, to be moral is to be a member of a community and to really interact with others. And this interaction, argues Thorpe, is possible in reality only if the individuals are autonomous. The individuals are free to choose to be a part of community or to lead a solipsistic life. Since they are rational, they will not prefer to lead an isolated life because their interests can be fulfilled only by being with other members of the society in which they are living. Only autonomous beings can construct and follow laws that are conducive to the unity of all individuals. One can note, for instance, that despite accepting the autonomy of the individual as central to moral and political life, Kant also accommodated the concept of a community. In support of liberals, one can argue that Rawls has also presented the notion of political community in the form of a social union. According to him, a political community cannot be established on any one comprehensive and general doctrine. Social union exists when there is an overlapping consensus on a reasonable political conception of justice. Rawls claims, "I believe there is no practicable alternative superior to the stable political unity secured by an overlapping consensus on a reasonable political conception of justice." Hence, in terms of Rawls, a community is not limited in sharing same tradition or culture or accepting some religious and social doctrines. A community is a social union which unites people on the rational foundation of the principles of justice. In this social union, people may have opposing philosophical, moral, and religious doctrines. It is not based on any particular conception of good. Besides the notion of an overlapping consensus, Rawls has also mentioned the idea of a society as a fair system of cooperation which incorporates two companion fundamental ideas, the idea of the person as a citizen and the idea of a well-ordered society. The members of a well-ordered society have a common goal, namely the goal of establishing a just framework in which all possible people can freely and equally exercise and achieve their own conception of good. It shows that the society is not just an aggregate of individuals who only cooperate for their own benefit. As far as the notion of community, as has been mentioned by the communitarians, is concerned, it is from Rawls' perspective merely one possibility among many that may be pursued by antecedently individuated selves within a framework already defined by principles of justice. Hence, the liberal thinkers cannot be accused for neglecting the role of community in the lives of individuals. While holding on to enhancing the autonomy of individuals, they also accept that the good of a community is important as the individuals are the members of such communities and they cannot live their lives in isolation. But the difference between the communitarians and the liberals is that whereas the communitarians only focus on the good of a community and overlook the conception of the good of each unique individual, liberals have given primacy to the autonomy of an individual over the good of a community. For the liberals, the rights, freedom, and liberty of the individual are more important, and such freedom cannot be sacrificed for the good of the community. It is argued that if the community is taken as primary, it will become possible to justify authoritarianism and dictatorship in the name of the good of the community. It is in order to avoid these kinds of situations that liberals have primarily focused on the autonomy of individuals and given priority to the right over the good. Let us come to the notion of community difference, or difference between a liberal and communitarian understanding. The whole dialogue regarding the autonomy of the individual and the good of the community requires further explanation of the idea of community. What do we understand by the term community, and how do we define it? The term community is very ambiguous and can be defined in diverse ways. It may include a very small group living in the same locality or a large one like a nation. The question is, what constitutes a community, and what are those fundamental features that qualify a group to be a community? Andrew Mason has defined community as a moral notion. A community is different from a society where people cooperate with each other in order to achieve their own personal goals. On the other hand, in a community, a group of people get united on the basis of religion, nationality, culture, family, etc., where they are mutually concerned and do not exploit each other for their own individual personal benefit. The members of a community share common ends. It can be argued that individuals are not part of any one community. We belong to more than one community at the same time. Sandel and McIntyre are right in asserting that an individual is always associated with some tradition, culture, or community, and that is why it is not possible for an individual to serve his or her own ends without being influenced by his or her attachment to these communities. But the problem is that the good of one community may clash with that of other communities. In such cases, how a person can decide which one is more important or preferable than the other? It is true that one's views and ideas are formed within a tradition or community, a family, an institute, etc., but only partially and not completely. Different communities have diverse notions of the good, and an individual should have autonomy and liberty to choose between and to evaluate those diverse notions of the good. Apart from this fact, liberals have not denied the role of community. They have only claimed that the interests of the individuals cannot be sacrificed for the good of the community. They have also mentioned that they want to establish a just and fair society, which can be possible only if we realize concerns of the society. Rawls is the case in point. These liberal thinkers have also talked about public reason. There should be equal concern and respect for each other's conception of the good, and that includes the autonomy of the individuals to exercise their own capacity to behave rationally. There can again be various interpretations and notions of good life, and there can be no single way of defining a good life for all. In this case, if people are free to choose their own ends and they are tolerant enough to give due respect to others' choice, they will obviously behave in a moral way. Hence, even though the liberals have failed to emphasize the notion of community in their liberal individualism, their notion of the autonomy of an individual does not lack the foundation of relationship and social bond among the people. Liberalism does not accept any single idealistic and overwhelming picture of the good life because they believe in empirical reality. There cannot be any ideal and general good of a community for the attainment of which all individuals will work together. The concept of the good of a community may change over the period, and hence no one can present a whole set of required things that would be needed to attain that good. If by the good of the community one understands the well-being and happiness of its members that can be achieved in a liberal society, which endeavors to protect the autonomy of the individuals along with the just arrangement of the society, and this just arrangement may sometimes obstruct or interfere with the autonomy of the individuals, whenever that becomes indispensable for the protection and enhancement of the community. Hence, the exercise of the autonomous lives of the individuals is uncontested, but it is also noteworthy that it may be regulated in a few cases where one's autonomy may interfere with other person's liberty and the just arrangement of a society. Let us come to liberalism and the unencumbered self. It is claimed by the communitarians like Sandel that liberalism has presented an inadequate notion of self, failing to recognize that the self is embedded with and partially constituted by the communal commitments and bonds, which are not objects of choice. Another point has been raised by McIntyre that liberalism has compartmentalized the roles and values of an individual, each detached from the other, since it looks at the individuals as a single unit. McIntyre argues that human beings are dependent, rational animals. Liberal thinkers have only focused on the second and have forgot about the first and third ones. In answer to these points, it can be said that liberalism is not denying the importance of one's commitments and bonds to one's society, family, nation, etc. The purpose of liberal theory is to enhance this idea that individuals are not only parts of these communities, but they also have their own individual identity. Though it has been the subject of much criticism, Rawls' view of the original position is only a hypothetical situation in which he is trying to give equal consideration to each individual so that each can get the opportunity to exercise his own rational will. The self cannot be separated from its relations with others, but it should not be defined only in terms of these relations. The self has been compartmentalized, as has been mentioned by McIntyre, because of some noble causes. To separate the institution of religion from government, to discontinue the domination of church, to separate the realm of religion from the realm of politics, to draw a line between wealth and rank, to see the difference between person and office. Liberalism has brought the political separation of realms of values so that one realm cannot dominate the other one. Changes into one realm cannot alter other realms of values, and hence each realm can have autonomy. The goal of liberalism is to provide each individual with the power to rationally accept or criticize the values of these communities and to have the capability to exercise his or her own rational will, even against the values of these communities if they are detrimental to his or her notion of the good. The position of a person should not be determined by his affiliation to a particular community, but by his own capabilities and expertise, because apart from these communities like family, caste, nation, etc., which constitute our notion of good, though we can even choose to hold or reject the values of these communities too, there are many other communities of which we rationally choose or deny to be a part. Different social roles and communities possesses different notions of the good, and they cannot be singled out to any one overwhelming conception of the good. Even if we decide to be or naturally become the part of a community, it is not necessary that we accept all its values as our own. People of the same community can have varied notions of the good. We cannot accurately say that our roles determine our good without adding that we often choose our roles because of the goods attached to them. In this case, there cannot be any single conception of the good which everyone can adhere to. In this condition, the hypothesis of the unencumbrance of the self prior to the establishment of the society in the original position becomes a necessary condition for the success of the encumbrances of the self in modern social conditions. In this way, liberalism has endeavored to look at a person as an individual and to recognize his or her significance in the society without regarding his or her religion, race, ethnicity, etc. Sandel has alleged that the liberal notion of the self presupposes the nature of self, and in order to be a liberal self, one has to be a particular kind of self under the condition of the original position, which is fixed, unalterable, and extensively individuated. This kind of liberal self lacks self-knowledge and is a mere agent of choice, not an agent of cognition. Liberalism is a theory which rests, according to Thomas Nagel, not on a claim to truth, but on a higher order impartiality in which liberals exercise epistemological restraint and put aside their ultimate personal convictions. It can be argued that Sandel's objection to the notion of liberal self is erroneous. It can be said that the liberal values are very strong and superseding. They are so because liberals are trying to shape our perception as independent of our attachments to our relationships, our ends and notions of good, etc. On the other hand, communitarians like McIntyre, who have presented the notion of telos, are not free of this objection, since the notion of telos, a specific goal, ascertains a certain type of human nature, which might be fulfilled only when achieving such an ultimate goal of human life. Whereas liberalism only presumes certain characteristics of the self, communitarianism not only provides the definition of right and wrong, and virtues, but also presents the pre-decided goal or end of the whole human life. It is true that the individual is not free to choose to be a part of certain communities like family, nation, etc. But communitarianism moves one step ahead and asserts that the individual is not even free to choose his or her own goal of life. He or she cannot freely think or work as an individual. An individual is always seen to be a part or member of a community and hence has responsibility to reach the common good of the community. So, according to the communitarian picture of moral personality, reflection on values and connections like place, but often as a matter of self-discovery rather than self-creation. On this view, people do not or do not always review their commitments and connections in order to validate or to reject them. Rather, they look into themselves and at their relations with surrounding others to try to better understand what constitutes their own identity, what connections lie at the root of their moral being, and provide the basis of their judgments. The alternative liberal model would understand these reflections as a process of decision and choice. Should I remain a Catholic or consider another faith? Should I reject the values of my culture? Do I really connect with my community anymore? On the communitarian view, however, such questions cannot reasonably be asked in that manner, but would take the form, as a Catholic, do I continue to feel as deeply about my faith? Is my culture or community going in the right direction? One discovers aspects of oneself and perhaps questions aspects of the larger movements and value systems of which one is a part, but one does not ask whether or not to be a part of them. In order to develop a theory which presents a political arrangement where everyone can be free and autonomous to exercise his or her own conception of the good, it becomes necessary to portray a certain notion of the self, a self capable of self-control, of reasonableness, of rationalizing things, of limiting or determining its own goal and ends in accordance with the rights of others, of respecting others' conceptions of good. Liberalism defines and presents certain features of the self so that once the well-ordered society is established, it can let the self be free to choose, evaluate, and exercise its own ends. Liberalism, as has been described by Rawls, does not offer all sorts of values to answer all the ultimate questions of life, but it does let the people choose and decide their own values in accordance with the principles of justice. Let us look at a pluralistic society. The liberal commitment to the autonomy and liberty to choose one's own conception of good results in citizens affirming competing and conflicting conceptions of the good. Hence, the fact of reasonable pluralism is a natural and intended consequence of liberalism. We cannot have any single and universal common good. There are many incompatible notions of good. This is why Berlin says that if, as I believe, the ends of men are many and not all of them are in principle compatible with each other, then the possibility of conflict and of tragedy can never wholly be eliminated from human life, either personal or social. This conflict among various notions of good is preferable to accepting only one single, universal and overpowering notion of good and disregarding the other ones. The plurality of conflicting or incompatible theories of human good does not inevitably result in an inability to reach any level of consensus in modern liberal societies. Despite the differences in the views of various liberal thinkers, they have collectively accepted the importance of human rights and the liberty of individuals. It shows that consensus can be established, if not on all, but at least on one or two values, which provides hope and scope for more compromise and agreement. The goal of liberalism is to provide sound reasons as to why a diverse population of citizens committed to different moral and religious affiliations ought to come together in the embrace of liberal values, even as they maintain their otherwise entrenched but mutually rational disagreements. Isa Berlin has provided one of the earliest attempts to defend a version of liberal pluralism. By presenting the two concepts of liberty, negative and positive, he argues that since liberalism endorses people with the freedom without coercion in the form of negative liberty, to choose any conception of good among a diversity of values, it is completely compatible with pluralism. Liberalism provides the best form of government to preserve human diversity and at the same time to construct a well-ordered society. On the other hand, George Croder, discusses the principles of pluralism as well as the principles of liberalism and shows that the principles of pluralism can best be accommodated within the principles of liberalism. These thinkers rightly hold that liberalism is the best possible theory to accommodate and justify the demands of pluralism. The fundamental principles of liberalism, like individual autonomy, protection of basic liberty and rights, equality, and the primacy of justice, imply that people holding different values and conceptions of the good can stay together without leaving behind their own diverse conceptions of the good. This is possible because even if there are numerous and incompatible conceptions of good and values, there is some common ground on the basis of which these values and conceptions of good can be held together if they are provided with the freedom without coercion to exercise their own values. In order to achieve such a condition, people should be reasonable and rational enough to understand the requirement of the plural society, and if anyone tries to impose one's values on others or interferes with the other's values, then the state will actively interfere and protect the rights of others. This point can best be seen in the views of Rawls. In political liberalism, he presents a freestanding political conception of justice and attempts to establish an overlapping consensus among the plural but comprehensive moral and religious doctrines. In a well-ordered society guided by the principles of justice, every comprehensive doctrine will be able to pursue its own conceptions of good while living peacefully in a plural society. It can be said against this that there may be some non-liberal conceptions of good that do not accept and even contradict the principles of liberalism. In that case, to establish the overlapping consensus on the liberal values would become impossible. Further, if we are trying to get that consensus over liberal values, then how can such consensus be said to protect the sanctity of pluralism? The answer to these questions is that those societies which are non-liberal are free to pursue their own conceptions of good if they do not interfere with the rights and values of other societies. The condition for such an overlapping consensus is that people should be reasonable towards others, towards their values. Another point is that while it is true that liberalism is trying to establish consensus over liberal values, it is compatible with the conditions of plurality because no other theory can provide a wide scope for diverse conceptions of the good to flourish in a plural society. It can certainly be argued that liberalism does not provide a comprehensive morality. Liberalism only regulates our social institutions in such a way that all societies which hold a comprehensive morality can live together in a peaceful way. Liberalism does not try to regulate our entire life, but provides such principles along with the fairest possible consensus for a pluralist society on the basis of which we can lead our lives according to our own rational plan of the good life. Let us come to the neutrality of the state. Another challenge for liberalism is to present a coherent, defensible liberal theory of the function of the state, which differs in principle from authoritarian and anti-liberal theories. Liberalism has primarily advocated the republican and democratic forms of government. It is presumed that the society has been established according to a social contract in which people entrust their power to the state in order to establish a just constitution. It will be a government of laws, not men. One system of laws applies to government officials and citizens alike, where citizens have power to challenge the acts of the government. Liberal justifications of rebellion and civil disobedience make citizens the ultimate enforcers of basic political and constitutional values. Hence, the proper role of the state is to protect the basic liberties and rights of its citizens and not to impose any particular conception of the good life. Neutrality is thought to best advance the goal of treating persons with equal concern and respect, or as free and equal rational beings in political decision making. Rawls said that the individuals are free to pursue their own conceptions of good, to practice their own religion, to participate in political associations and social groups, to enjoy a realm of privacy within the broad limits of the power of the state. The state should remain neutral towards citizens' conception of the good life. Neutrality of the state leads to the distinction between the public and the private realms. When someone's private approach towards anything interferes with or violates the code of public behavior, then the state controls those activities. The distinction between the private and the public, and the limited control of the state over the lives of people, is the extension of the liberal insistence on the priority of the right over the good. Now we come to the priority of the right over the good, and we should have a look at it now, where plurality in the accepted valid conceptions of the good requires neutrality of the state. The neutrality of the state implies the primacy of justice, which encompasses the priority of the right over the good. The right should be prior to the good, so that everyone's search for the good can be protected by the rights, like equality, autonomy, welfare, good, basic liberty, etc., provided by the society. The priority of the right or justice does not imply that the individuals are antecedently individuated, as has been mentioned by Sandel, but that it will provide us the fairest way of sharing goods of citizenship with people who do not accept any conception of the good. Even if we consider that our identity is constituted by our conception of the good, that conception of the good must include the notion of rights and justice. The right should be accepted as primary so that everyone can pursue his or her own conceptions of the good without being controlled by anyone else's conception of the good. According to John Rawls, the principles of right puts limit on which satisfaction have value. They impose restriction on what are reasonable conceptions of one's good. Some thinkers have complained that the priority of the right is to protect, first of all, the liberal virtues like basic liberty, individual autonomy, etc. So they too have given priority to their own conception of the good and then accordingly have provided the principles of right. Sandel has primarily raised this objection and has claimed that rights cannot be identified and justified in a way that does not presuppose any conception of the good life. Liberalism promotes one particular view of the good under the cover of the priority of the right, and hence it cannot be said to be neutral toward other conceptions of good. It can be argued that though Rawls, A Theory of Justice, was guilty of that charge as it presented the comprehensive view of principles of justice, but political liberalism was free of these allegations as it only endeavored to establish a freestanding political conception of liberalism. Hence, its principles were only concerned to establish an overlapping consensus among the various conflicting and incompatible comprehensive conceptions of moral and religious doctrines. Instead of presenting its conception of good, Rawls emphasized the primacy of justice in society, which is the precondition for peaceful and stable living of the individuals holding different conceptions of the good. Therefore, Rawls' principles of justice were political and non-comprehensive. Here it can be argued that liberal values like basic liberty, the idea of the attainment of the primary goods, and the protection of the rights, etc., are the values which every theory must adhere to as far as the primacy of justice and individual autonomy are concerned. They are the necessary foundations for a modern democratic society. Right has been considered to be prior only for the sake of protection of the good, and one's notion of the good can exist only if conflicting conceptions of the good are following the principles of right. In this sense, the right and the good are complementary. If the good tells us what our general direction and our ultimate goal should be, the right tells us what the legitimate options are there to go to. Let us conclude. To conclude, it can be said that the fundamental aim of liberal theorists, especially deontologists, is to establish a just society where everyone's rational plan of life can be achieved. The objections that have been raised by various thinkers, especially communitarians, are useful for the liberal thinkers as they provide them with the tools necessary to revise, reevaluate, and improve their theory. But these objections are not sufficient to theoretically demolish liberalism, as this theory has proved itself to be one of the most significant political theories. No other theory has been able to provide such a wide notion of a society, which includes diverse and plural groups. The communitarian criticism is based on the misleading polarization of individual and community. These two conceptions, individuals and community, are interdependent. One cannot exist without the other. The communitarians have criticized the theory of liberalism for emphasizing the autonomy and rights of individuals and ignoring the role of community in the life of an individual. But liberal thinkers have never attempted to bifurcate these two notions. They have only given more importance to the one individual over the other, that is community, in order to end the tyranny of the hierarchical order of the communities. Whereas the communitarians have completely overlooked the function, role and growth of the individuals in the community, liberals have endeavored to reconcile these two concepts. There should be a political system which harmonizes both of them. The duty of the state should be to enhance the opportunities in such a way that the individuals could flourish according to their own rational will, which can be influenced and constituted by their being a part of a particular community or many communities. But at the same time, it is the duty of the state as well as of every individual to evaluate and examine the rules, values and traditions of a community according to the principles of justice, so that the autonomy and rights of the individuals can be preserved with the development of the communities. It is easy to point out the logical or theoretical inconsistencies in a theory, but very difficult to provide a perfect theory consisting of coherent political, moral and philosophical doctrines. Though communitarians like Michael Sandel and Alasdair MacIntyre have marked significant problems in the theory and practice of liberalism for helping liberals to discover a politics that combines community with a commitment to basic liberal values, they themselves were not able to provide any comprehensive political theory. Both Sandel and MacIntyre could not provide an accurate account of their foundations. They, instead of trying to seek the harmony between the two concepts of individual and community, have glorified and romanticized the importance of community, tradition, and the common good. It should be understood that a community cannot exist without its members, and the common good cannot be achieved or established without the individuals. If merely establishing the autonomy of individuals without noticing their association with the communities and the notion of good is misleading, the bare worship of the attachments to the communities and its values and the attainment of the common good are inept, futile, and detrimental. It is the truth of the modern world that people disagree about the nature of the good life, and liberalism appeals to the reconciliation rather than repression of most of the competing conceptions of good life under the supervision and protection of the principles of right and justice. It is not to argue that liberalism is free of mistakes or problems, but that liberalism is one of the most significant theories to provide a ground to establish a well-ordered society. However, liberalism should recognize that commitment to liberal values in itself constitute a comprehensive view, and this view can come into conflict with rival accounts of the good. Such conflicts have the potential to seriously damage the pluralistic structure of contemporary democratic societies. Therefore, liberal theory and practice needs to reflect on the importance of respecting values that may not be liberal, so that liberal, plural and multicultural societies can allow minorities to promote their individual accounts of the good. So let us see the learning outcome of this module. It discusses one of the significant issues of the contemporary political philosophy. This module examines the relations between individual and community and state and its citizens, the relations between individuals through the debate between liberalism and communitarianism, two of the most influential theories of the contemporary political theory. This module is aimed at dealing with contemporary issues of how to accommodate one's notion of the good in a plural society. This issue is very relevant in today's world, where every now and then we have to deal with the plurality of human existence. It also focuses on the capability of an individual to revise, reevaluate, and leave one's own affiliations. This gives an individual an opportunity to transcend one's existence. The views of liberal thinkers show how the discourse of individuals' rights and liberties have changed the lives of people in society, and on the other hand, how the communitarian critiques have helped the liberal tradition to develop in a consistent manner. Thank you very much. Thank you for being with us, and I hope this module has been informative and is of help to you. Thank you.